So I'm going to run through and tell you a little bit about ReNeuron. Apologies for those that already know something of our story, as I'll be going over probably some old ground, but hopefully there are enough people that won't be so familiar, and hopefully you'll get something from the next 20 minutes or so. Sarah did say LSE quoted. We're actually quoted on AIM, but yes, we are worth about 42 odd million as of today. And we are a pure play biotech business, and we are focused on harnessing the scientific and clinical potential of stem cells. So we are a stem cell therapy company, and we've been doing this for many years now. So we're one of the pioneering plays, if you like, in this particular field. We have sites both in the UK and also in the US, and we're developing allogeneic stem cell technology platforms. And allogeneic, it means non-patient specific. So in other words, we're trying to develop therapies that any patient that presents with the diseases we're targeting can have administered to them. And that's in contrast to the autologous approach, which involves manipulation of the patient's own stem cells, which certainly has its place in terms of certain disease conditions. But we believe the indications we're targeting, an allogeneic approach offers the best chance of commercial success in the long run. We have two clinical stage candidates, which I'll cover in turn this evening, and some significant clinical milestones we're targeting over the next 18 months. The platforms we've developed sort of broadly split into three categories, as you see here. The first category is our HRPC cells, or human retinal progenitor cells. These are retinal cells derived from retinal tissue, and they are targeting, unsurprisingly, back of the eye retinal degenerative diseases. The first target is retinitis pigmentosa. This is a clinical stage candidate. We have early positive phase 2A data, which I'll take you through shortly. The program's partnered with Fosun Pharma for China, or Greater China. That was a deal we struck on both our core clinical assets last year. And it's one of a number of deals we would like to strike in terms of out-licensing these programs as the data set builds clinically. The way that we deliver these cells is by direct injection. And in order to provide the best chance of commercialization, we've been able to cryopreserve our HRPCs with a long shelf life to enable ready manufacture, ship and store, and use at the clinical site when required. The second asset we've developed, which is actually the first one we developed in time, is our CTX cells. And this is a neural progenitor stem cell line. And in this case, this is immortalized. So it's actually genetically engineered to expand the cells to produce a continuous cell line, which means we don't have to re-derive from fresh tissue, as we would have to do in due course with the first asset, the HRPC. So again, it's a slightly different approach to generating an allogeneic cell therapy product. Again, we have positive phase 2A data with this asset, and it's currently in a phase 2B study in the States. Again, partnered with Fosun Pharma, they took a license on both these assets, as I mentioned. And again, same modality, a cryopreserved formulation of these cells on a long shelf life in common with the HRPCs. More recently, we've developed a couple of newer platforms derived from our CTX cell line in terms of their exosomic potential and also induced pluripotent cells derived from our CTX cells. These are earlier stage assets, and the long and short of it is that we intend to collaborate with third-party companies in the case of exosomes to help those companies deliver their drugs more effectively, and in the case of the iPS cells to generate new cell lines derived from those iPS cells for subsequent licensing. So it's very much a licensing model that we're adopting from the get-go in those newer assets. But again, I'll come back to those if there's time towards the end. So our clinical pipeline here is given here. And as I mentioned, the two clinical stage assets are both in phase two, phase 2A in the case of the HRPCs targeting retinitis pigmentosa, in phase 2B, or in the middle of a phase 2B study, in the case of our CTX cells, which are targeting stroke disability. And again, I'll come back to both these programs shortly. So just spending a little bit of time first on the HRPC program. And as I mentioned, this is an allogeneic cell-based therapeutic approach to retinal diseases. So in other words, HRPC cells we regard as a platform technology the first target being retinitis pigmentosa. So we do see scope to expand clinically into other indications when resources allow. And the reason we're excited about our HLPCs is that we know that they do have the ability to differentiate into functional photoreceptors and integrate into the retinal layers. So in other words, they can address the loss of photoreceptors that are typically manifest in back of the eye retinal degeneration. And we have a wealth of preclinical evidence and obviously IND enabling studies that show that, most of which has now been published. We are actually targeting inherited retinal degenerative diseases first. So we're going for the rare or orphan status diseases, and retinitis pigmentosa is the first target, as I mentioned. The technology was originally developed in conjunction with Harvard Medical School, or the Scapin's Eye Research Institute, which is part of Harvard, over in Boston. And we've worked with other leading institutions, including Moorfields at UCL, over the years as well, to develop and optimize this technology, both in terms of its preclinical efficacy and also to optimize the way that we scale and manufacture these cells, if you will, and also to enhance or optimize the formulation, which in the case of these cells is a cryopreserve formulation proprietary to us, which currently provides a 9-month shelf life. So we're targeting retinitis pigmentosa as the first indication for our HLPCs, as I mentioned. RP is an inherited disease, degenerative eye disease, characterized by well over 100 individual mutations, which collectively form retinitis pigmentosa as a disease. And it's manifest in really what you see in the panels on the right-hand side here, a gradual loss of peripheral vision, which can occur over a large number of years, actually, or even decades, but ultimately leads to blindness. This particular program we're running has orphan drug designation in Europe and the US. It's actually quite a large, one of the largest orphan indications, as it turns out, but it is orphan status. And we also have fast track designation from FDA for this one as well. The benefit we see with using a cell-based approach for RP, even though it's a genetically mediated disease, is that obviously a cell-based approach is gene independent. So we may not be addressing the underlying genetic cause of the disease, but we are fully addressing, as we hope anyway, the essentially what's manifest in this disease, which is a loss of photoreceptors. So we're hopefully arresting the further loss of photoreceptors in these patients and also replacing lost photoreceptors through the differentiation and integration potential of these cells, as I mentioned. In terms of the clinical development with HLPCs, we're currently in the middle of a phase 1-2A combined study in the US. We've completed the phase 1 element of this study in 12 patients, which was obviously primarily driven for both safety data and also to monitor escalating dose as well. And since then, we've also treated 10 patients in the phase 2A part of this study. Again, the primary endpoint being safety, but also monitoring efficacy measures, including visual acuity, visual field, and so on. Currently, it's being run in two US clinical sites at Mass Eye near in Boston, and the RRI over in Phoenix. And it's fair to say that we've been incredibly excited by the early data we've seen in this in the phase 2A segment of this 1-2 combined study. And this is really just a snapshot of the data. We actually announced an update, I think it was back in February this year. We started announcing data from this study, which is an open label study, about a year or so ago. And so we've been sort of seeing how those patients progress on an open label basis ever since. So this is a snapshot, again, as we announced a little while ago, and it monitors patients on visual acuity using the ETDRS chart, which you see an image of there on the bottom right-hand panel. So it's a fairly standardized test for visual acuity using a chart. It's kind of an upside down Snellen chart, I guess, as you would see in an optician's. And what you're seeing in the two lines here is the visual acuity measured individually in patients between the untreated eye and the treated eye. So although this is not a controlled study, it is single arm, we are using the untreated eye in each of these patients as a quasi-control. And you can see the net positive difference over time in each of these patients. And that's a difference that's really meaningful. If we can replicate and sustain these differences between treated and untreated within the context of a fully controlled study, which we intend to do next, then we really have a product of interest here. So we're very, very excited by what we see in these data. And as a consequence of that, we're looking to expand the study really to treat more patients to try and optimize the signal that we've already seen. And the reason we want to extend the existing study is that we believe if the data holds, then that should provide us with an opportunity to move into a single pivotal pre-approval clinical study, obviously allowing a shorter time to market, assuming the data continues to play out to the positive. Obviously, this is an orphan indication, so it does provide an ability for us to pursue that kind of clinical pathway. Again, we announced a short while ago this year that we were opening up this study to a UK site in Oxford under Robert McLaren, who's one of the leading doyens in this field. And we're also modifying the protocol, again, to give us the best chance of success here in terms of patient selection, dose, which will be increasing from 1 million to 2 million cells per patient, and also a number of new efficacy measurements to amplify the current signal we're seeing. If resources allow, we'd also like to test test the HRPCs in other indications, including cone rod dystrophy, another rare genetically mediated disease of the retina, as and when resources allow. But our current focus for the immediate term, at least, is on the RP program. Excuse me, just drop my phone. I'm actually timing myself here. So moving on to the CTX cells quickly. So again, a very different cell asset, but again, it follows the same philosophy of using stem cells in an allogeneic or non-patient specific setting. And again, a cryopreserved cell therapy candidate to allow for the greatest commercial benefit, if you will, from a cost of goods and logistical perspective. Our CTX cells we've been working with for many, many years. It's a neural progenitor cell line. So these are brain cells that, again, have the ability to differentiate. They are multipotent cells, so they will differentiate into cell types associated with the organ of origin, neurons, astrocytes, oligodendrocytes. We've produced a lot of preclinical and subsequent clinical data showing a good safety profile for these cells, their non-immunogenic potential evidenced both preclinically and clinically, and again, an ability to manufacture and cryopreserve these cells in a ready way using formulations that are proprietary to us. And in common with other cell types, and if you follow the stem cell therapy field more generally, you'll see this with other cell types, including mesenchymal cells. But stem cells typically are multimodal in terms of their mechanisms of action. And in terms of our CTX cells, they are brain cells. So we know and have shown preclinically that they have an ability to stimulate neurogenesis, the generation of new neurons in the brain, angiogenesis, new blood vessel growth, and also an ability to modulate the immune system as well as releasing paracrine factors to assist in brain repair ultimately. And we've used these effects to really target the first indication for CTX, which we've been working on for a while now, and that is stroke disability, which as the slide describes here is a huge unmet medical need if you suffer a stroke and are left disabled by it. Which accounts for a large number of patients that suffer an ischemic stroke, which is the single largest type of stroke. The other type is hemorrhagic, which is around 10% of all strokes, but the vast majority are ischemic in nature. And it's those stroke survivors, ischemic stroke survivors, that we're targeting with CTX here, with the aim of essentially promoting repair in the damaged brain using CTX, and thereby engendering a better quality of life for these patients and reduce dependence post-stroke on health and social care. And one of the ways of measuring that is by use of the modified Rankin scale, which is a classic measure of disability. It's a 5-point scale, and as you see in the panel on the right hand side here, the lower you are down on this measure, the less disabled or dependent you are. And the graph actually here was taken from a published registry study in Sweden from a couple of years or so ago in over 40,000 disabled patients. And it really shows you the pharmacoeconomic benefit of knocking patients down a level on the modified Rankin scale. And as you can see, the sweet spot here is knocking them down from MRS 4 to 3 or 3 to 2. And those are the patients that we're targeting in our current phase 2b study in the US as an entry criteria. In terms of the clinical data we've already generated with CTX and stroke disability, we've published a phase one safety study, and we recently published a phase 2A study. The data from that study is snapshot here. And you can see that on the modified ranking, we had a response rate of interest in these patients. These were 23 disabled stroke patients treated with CTX cells at a 20 million cell dose between 2 and 12 months post their stroke. And we measured these patients out to 12 months post-implantation of cells. So we're excited by the potential of CTX to engender repair, permanent repair, in the brains of disabled stroke patients. And that has led us to commence a phase 2B randomized placebo-controlled study that's ongoing in the US in 130 patients, 2-to-1 randomized to the treatment, treated 6 to 24 months post-stroke with modified Rankin levels of disability 3 and 4 going into the study. Primary endpoint is modified Rankin at 6 months post-treatment, with a number of typical disability endpoints and quality of life measures that you see listed here as well.
Got 5 minutes, Michael.
Thank you. And one thing I should note, we are a closed period ahead of our prelim results. So unfortunately, I'm unable to give as much guidance as I'd like to you in terms of the status of these programs and where they're headed, and also some of the financials, as I would normally be able to do. So I would urge you, if you're interested, to watch out for our prelim results coming up probably later this month. We haven't actually announced the date yet, but we will be doing so shortly. We normally announce in late June or early July, off of March year end. And we will be giving a full update across all of these programs when we do that, if not before, actually. So again, my apologies for not being more forthright with guidance on where these programs are going in the future, but you will be able to see that in short order if you care to. So just a quick word in the time I have remaining on our earlier stage platforms. Specifically our exosomes and iPS cells derived from our CTX cell line. If I can move this forward. So exosomes are a field of increasing interest. Actually, there are some players now fully immersed in exploiting the potential of exosomes, as we are. Companies like Evox here in the UK and Kodiak in Boston over in the US. Exosomes are nanoscale vesicles released by most cell types. They're heavily involved in intracellular communication and are now playing a role in delivery of novel therapeutic agents. And to that end, we've derived our first CTX-derived exosome candidate, and we do see its potential both as a therapeutic in its own right, but initially as a drug delivery vehicle, and that's where we're currently exploiting CTX in collaboration with third parties that are looking for novel delivery systems for their advanced drugs, such as proteins, genes, oligonucleotides, and so on. And including, actually, as Sarah mentioned at the start, potentially COVID-19 viral vaccines as well, which is where we do believe our exosome can play a role. And again, we're working collaboratively towards that end as well. Again, I won't take you through this in the interest of time, but we do see advantages in both generic exosomes over more conventional delivery vehicles for gene therapies and so on. And specific examples or advantages to ReNeuron's exosome technology over other exosome types. Obviously, our exosomes are derived from a clinical grade product. It's xeno-free. It can be manufactured scalably under GMP conditions. It has established analytics, and we've shown in a number of presentations over the last couple of years, actually, the ability of our exosomes to load small RNAs, proteins, CRISPR-Cas9 proteins, and a number of other agents as well, and importantly, to carry those across the blood-brain barrier, which is one of the big challenges in this field. And finally, our CTX-derived iPS cells, again, this is very new technology for us, but we have shown recently the ability of our CTX cells to be taken back or reprogrammed to a pluripotent state, so an embryonic stem cell-like state, and from that to be able to then differentiate those cells down into new cell types like mesenchymal cells, hematopoietic cells, and so on. So it's a way of actually using what we've already got to derive new cell lines for subsequent out-licensing to those players that wish to work with those cell types from an established clinical grade cell line, of course. So in summary, just to wrap up, we are a global leader in cell-based therapeutics. We've been doing this for a long time and have ticked a lot of the boxes that it takes to generate viable cell-based therapies in this field. Our cell-based therapies are allogeneic in nature. They're patented, scalable, and ultimately cost-effective from a commercial standpoint. We're targeting unmet medical needs. We have clinical milestones that we're due to hit over the next 18 months. And again, look out for future guidance in the near term in that regard. And we do see some value-generating potential to do further deals beyond the license that we signed with Fosun Pharma last year. And with that, I'm happy to take some questions. Thank you.
Many thanks, Michael. Well, as I started at the beginning in my introduction, you are London listed, and here you are on this placeholder saying global leader in cell-based therapeutic sites in the UK and the US, and the retinitis pigmentosa candidate has fast-track designation status in the US. So would you consider a NASDAQ listing?
Yes, I mean, again, we're an AIM-listed biotech company, and that comes with its own set of challenges. So I don't think it's any great secret to say that, you know, at the right time, we would consider listing on the US exchange. There's obviously a much larger peer group, most especially actually in our subsector. But ultimately, there has to be a very good reason to do that in terms of valuation, finance need, and ultimate value growth as well. So I think, you know, whenever a NASDAQ listing happens, it's got to be done at the right time to ensure success. It's quite possible to list on NASDAQ and actually not really achieve what perhaps you might have set out to achieve in terms of value build and so on. So the story's got to be right to have reached its right stage. I suspect we're slightly short at the moment on clinical data. But that will change soon, all being well, and I think that will open up opportunities for us. But no immediate plan.
Okay, so more clinical data forthcoming. Very exciting. Paul Mallett asks you this. Has the regulator approved the protocol amendments for the RP study, and when will treatment start with 2 million cells dose?
I'm going to be incredibly irritating here and refer to my earlier comments to say watch out for the guidance that we'll update within the next month as part of our prelim announcement, or possibly separately. And I really can't and shouldn't say more than that at the moment. But thank you very much for pointing out what we did announce a month or two ago, whenever it was, which was an expansion of that RP study into other sites in the US and also into that site in Oxford in the UK as well.
Okay, I don't mind if you repeat yourself, Michael. Andrew Nesbitt writes, why does the untreated eye improve in the phase 2A study? You would expect it to stay the same.
Yeah, it's a very, very interesting and good question. And it's not a question we can fully answer. It's phenomenological. It's been seen before in studies like this. There is some kind of sympathetic effect that you do see in some patients, not all, but some in the untreated eye. The data is in the graph I showed is just a snapshot. It doesn't really adequately show patient by patient data, of course, although we have presented that in conference over the last year. So it's difficult to get a sense for what's going on in each patient, but you do see quite enhanced untreated eye effects in a small number of those patients. So overall, it's important to look at the deltas here. That's what really matters. Are we engendering a significant difference in effect between treated and untreated in and of itself? And that's where we draw the encouragement from the data we've seen so far. But I can't give you an adequate scientific explanation for what you've asked about, I'm afraid.
Okay, let's see if you can give an adequate scientific explanation to Ian Davis's question. He asks, you mentioned that the CTX cells are immortalized. I'm wondering if that leads to an increased risk of those cells becoming cancerous.
Yeah, that's a great question as well. And in the days when we actually initiated that program, That was a key concern from a regulatory as well as a scientific and clinical standpoint. It was tumorigenicity and immunogenicity of allogeneic cell-based approaches. We have the actual baggage that we use to expand the cells or genetically modify them is chemically controlled. So we know that that expansion technology is inert once the chemical is removed from the cell media. And as you might expect, we had to test that empirically, exhaustively as part of our preclinical package in order to get these cells into a first clinical trial in the first place. Here in the UK and subsequently, of course, in the US. So it's a great question, but empirically, we know that the CTX cell line is incredibly benign from a safety perspective. Once it's introduced, we have never seen a tumorigenic or immune issue with the cells in any of the patients we've treated or in any of the preclinical studies. And indeed, it's worth noting that we don't actually immunosuppress patients in either the stroke program or indeed in the RP program when these cells are injected. And it's a surgical procedure in both cases, actually. So again, that kind of enhances the safety profile in some regards, of course, because of, immune drugs, of course, have their own safety issues associated with them.
I'm going to merge two questions here, Michael. Frank Gregory asks, you once had a large Woodford shareholding. Can you update us on what your shareholder base looks like now? And Tom Eyre also asking, please update us on your shareholder register.
Hi, Frank. So we were a Woodford stock. In fact, the Woodford Fund, the Income Fund, and the what was the Patient Capital Trust held between them about a third of the register. The Income Fund part of that's now been sold to a German family office called Obertricia. If you look on our website, you'll see a list of the shareholders as they currently are. And the Patient Capital Trust holding is now in the hands of Schroders, as I'm sure most of you will know, the Schroders UK Public Private Trust, I think it's now known as. So as far as we're concerned, we are all being well through the Woodford situation, which did, of course, cause us some issues last year. But we are very happy with the way that the major part of the shareholder base now looks in terms of those institutions and their capacity to run with the story through to value inflection.
I need you to help me with this, Michael, in terms of giving some background information, because Paul Mallett writes, what's your view of J-Site and their recent deal? Will they beat you to the market? So what's the backstory to that?
Yeah, J-Site are one of our closest peers. So again, they're using retinal progenitor cells in RP. The mode of administration is different. The way that the cells are manufactured is different. But we're quite comfortable with J-Site as a competitor in this field. We await their phase two data. They've obviously produced data. It hasn't been publicly announced yet to our knowledge, but clearly they've been able to sign a very substantive deal with the Japanese partner a few weeks back. And we draw a lot of encouragement from that. I mean, as I mentioned earlier, one of our ambitions is to continue to strike out licensing deals when data emerges. And there's plenty of scope for more than one player in this particular field, especially as these are platform products, remember. So they do have scope beyond the initial indications we're targeting. But we're quite comfortable with our position in the areas that we're targeting currently.
And finally, you used the word excited quite a lot tonight. Do you know how many times you said it?
God, no. You're going to tell me, though, aren't you?
I am. It's kind of lucky. It's seven. So you mentioned the word excited seven times. So what are you most excited about in terms of the business?
I think the excitement to my mind, and I've been with this business a long time, is having gone through the sort of slings and arrows of developing these technologies. We do now seem to be at the point where you know, we're not far from the end game. Now, who knows which way the data will go ultimately, but I think we've tried to stack the odds as far as we can in our favor in terms of these clinical trials. And I don't think we're far off generating, you know, phase two data that really is compelling from the point of view of building value in this business and showing that, you know, cell therapies of this nature really do have their place in the milieu and are licensable prospects. And ultimately, after a long period of generating the data, we will be able to provide value back to our shareholders. And I really do think that that's, you know, we are not far off being able to get ourselves into that position, subject, of course, to the data continuing to play out to the positive, as it does seem to be doing, you know, so far.
Well, there you go. I'm excited. That makes it eight. Thank you very much, Michael Hunt, Chief Financial Officer of ReNeuron. It's always very good to see you. Thank you very much indeed.
Thanks, Sarah. Thank you, everyone.